Hi everybody, and welcome to the Tech Founders Show from Hays. In this series, we meet entrepreneurs whose startups and scale-ups are making an impact in the tech for good space. I'm your host, Robin Beattie, a recent addition to the Hays community with a focus on the Hays offering to the startup and scale-up ecosystem. And today, I'm delighted to be joined by Joe Seddon, CEO of Zero Gravity. Zero Gravity is an edtech startup that aims to make high-quality education accessible to students from all backgrounds and help them unlock their potential. Joe and Zero Gravity were the overall winners in the 2023 Super Connect for Good competition, an annual incentive from Hays and Empact Ventures to identify and support tech startups and scale-ups, making a positive societal difference. Joe is with us here today to tell us more about how he started the platform, his experience as an award-winning founder, and his thoughts on entrepreneurship. Firstly, congratulations on your win, and good to have you with us today.
Great to be on the podcast, Robin. Really looking forward to it.
Great. So, Joe, want to start with a big question. Can you share the story behind your startup and what motivated you to pursue this particular business idea?
Sure. It all starts with my personal story, really, which is I grew up in a single parent background in a small town in West Yorkshire called Morley, which is between Leeds and Wakefield. You probably can't tell my accent nowadays because it's been diluted over time, but I'm a northerner, and it was a sort of characterized Morley through the language that a lot of newspapers use. It's a kind of post-industrial town, a red wall seat, and my mum's a speech therapist in the NHS. I kind of made the journey from state schools to Oxford University, where I studied PPE, philosophy, politics and economics, not personal protective.
No.
And I just saw firsthand how large the barriers are for students like me who were kind of ambitious, wanted to defy the odds, but came from backgrounds where it wasn't the norm to break into elite institutions, whether it was financial anxiety growing up, not being able to afford private education or private tuition or even textbooks. They're coming from a community where it's not the norm to kind of flee the nest and do something different. And also, like, just not having the inside track from having a kind of powerful network of professionals around you. And I saw all of these different things, throughout my journey, and I wanted to change it. So when I graduated from Oxford, and I had a couple of corporate job offers, but I decided to turn them down and instead kind of go on the crazy tech startup journey. So I decided to go back and live in West Yorkshire with my mum and sister for a while, and Zero Gravity was born from my childhood bedroom. So it truly was a kind of bootstrapped startup experience, and the problem I set out to solve was the problem that I personally faced growing up, which is how do you break that link between background and opportunity. I wanted to find a way to scale that to tens of thousands of people like me who want to defy the odds but don't necessarily have the resources to do so.
Yeah, what a fantastic story. Really fantastic story. And what were the biggest challenges you faced in those early days? Because you said it was bootstrapped. You did it from your bedroom. So those two are already constraints I can easily see. What other challenges did you face in the early days?
It's quite ironic because I was founding a tech startup to try and solve the problem of social mobility. How do you break that link between someone's background and the opportunities they have access to? But I myself was facing those very same challenges when I was first starting Zero Gravity, which was I didn't have a network of entrepreneurs around me. I didn't really know anyone who'd started a business before. But my best exposure, I think, was studying GCSE business studies, where I think one of my business studies teacher had launched a kind of local party bag business for children's birthday parties. But that was about the extent of entrepreneurs that I had in my network. I didn't have any access to finance, so I had 200 quid left from my student loan, and that was my kind of startup capital. I came across this idea of friends and family funding, which I thought was completely bizarre, because I thought if I did a whip round of my friends and family, probably end up with around 20 quid and maybe a pack of skips. And I just didn't know how to get started because I didn't have the inside track on what it actually takes to found a company. You can watch as many inspiring TikTok or YouTube videos as you like, and that can be great in terms of shaping your mentality. But in terms of actually just the basics of getting started, like how do you form a company on company's house? How do you build a brand, marketing, building a platform? I had to learn all those things from scratch. So it was really, really difficult. And I think it's no surprise that 9 out of 10 the founders in the UK, you know, come from the most affluent backgrounds, because even when you're starting a company and trying to disrupt the system, you're still facing all those gravitational forces that kind of, you know, trap people in their backgrounds. And that's certainly what I faced. And the only way I was able to kind of overcome those forces was trying to find a way to make the system work for me. Mm-hmm. So I tried to kind of be a little bit unconventional and find ways around some of these barriers. Like when it came to fundraising, for instance, I knew I had no network. I knew I had no rich uncle I could lean on for a 50K investment. So what I really focused on in the early days was building a mission-driven brand that really resonated with people and created a PR flywheel out of that. And essentially all the investors in Zero Gravity I can trace back to news articles that essentially we got in the first year, where I was able to bring a network to me rather than me having to go to them, because they were just never in my orbit. So I kind of looked at these barriers and tried to find a way to kind of play the system, do things a little bit differently. But it was certainly a struggle in those early days. And any entrepreneurial journey is difficult. But if you are someone from a socially mobile background, then those barriers are even more tough than a typical startup founder would face.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And I can see those challenges. And it's quite incredible how you've overcome those. As you say, I've seen a lot of founders, and you're right, typically a lot of them, when you speak about their early days, they do have that rich uncle, that rich friend that they can call upon, or they've got connections that can actually help them get set up in the first place. So I think that just shows how far you've actually obviously come, Joe. And then I suppose a next obvious follow-on question from that is, then how did you go about assembling your team and finding the right people to help you build the startup? So whilst you've got that first bit of investment, how did you find those people?
Yes, it's a really big question, because in the early days as a solo founder, I had to become like the ultimate generalist, and I didn't have the financial resources to be able to hire people. So actually one of the key skills I think you need to learn in your kind of early bootstrap days as a founder is essentially skill acquisition. How do you acquire new skills and knowledge as quickly as possible and put those into practice? Because in the early days, you are the brand, you are the web developer, you are the social media manager, you do everything, and whether you succeed and fail essentially comes down to your own individual execution ability. But once we started, you know, making some revenue, we got some investment, that kind of equation changed, and it was no longer about, you know, me necessarily being the best individual contributor in the world. It became more, how do I hire the best people and get the most out of them to drive the business forward? And that was a really big challenge for me, because I'd never actually hired anyone before, and I'd certainly never managed a team. So suddenly I was facing all these very new challenges, which especially as a kind of introverted founder who was kind of more instinctively comfortable with ideas and theory and strategy rather than leadership and management, was a big learning curve. And I think the really important thing I did in the early days is I kind of did the work of trying to define what kind of culture I wanted to create at Zero Gravity. And I think a lot of businesses leave that exercise too late. You know, they wait until they're a massive, you know, 100 plus person organization. Maybe they've run into a few HR issues, and then they use that as a kind of as a time to sort of start thinking about culture. But I thought about it proactively from the beginning, which is I kind of sat down and I was like, if Zero Gravity was almost like a Sims character, what sort of character would it be? Like, what would its personality be, its values, its purpose? And I just kind of did that work and sort of documented it down. And once I'd done that, it became much easier to actually think about hiring people, because I knew exactly what kind of person I wanted. You know, the person, what kind of values do I want that person to exude? And it just gave me a framework for finding the right people. And then the culture kind of builds itself at that point from the people that you have around you in the early days of the business.
That's super insightful to do that, generally, Joe. So what made you think that? Was that something that you read? Is that something that you've seen other people do? What made you think, I'm going to set it out in this way and I'm going to go culture first?
I came across some interesting things online. I'd read the kind of Netflix culture book, which I suppose one of the defining documents in the tech startup sector. And I kind of just really appreciated like companies that had a very clear culture about them. There's a famous Mark Zuckerberg quote, which I'm going to kind of bastardize it here probably, but it's along the lines of, if you're making a statement about culture, it has to be something that some people will love and some people will hate. And I saw there was lots of wishy-washy stuff about culture online, but I thought, if I create something that's very distinctive and defining, and almost a little bit Marmite, so, something that some people will love, some people won't want to be part of, then I'll have something that has real substance, and I'll be able to build, you know, really kind of deep like culture around that. So I kind of took the idea and I kind of sat down, and again, a bit like I was using that analogy, the Sims character, I thought, if Zero Gravity was a person, what kind of person would it be? And I came up with a couple of different values, which I knew would put some people off coming to work at Zero Gravity, but I knew for other people, they'd be the sort of things that people love. And I think that just created such a clear character straight away, which made the recruitment process much easier, because now I would be able to assess those values against the people I was speaking to, and they would be able to do it the opposite direction as well. And through the interview process and finding out more about the culture, they'd also be able to filter themselves out in terms of if they were the sort of people up for that kind of challenge and way of working, or whether Zero Gravity wasn't for them. So I think culture in your hiring process is the best filter you can create. If you create a really distinctive culture and you make sure the people, the candidates in your hiring process, get a flavour of it, that's going to be one of the most important filters you can create. And I think it saves you so many problems down the track of, you know, making a bad hire who's not a good cultural addition to the organisation. They don't fully understand the culture before they join, and then it's only 3 or 4 months down the track those problems start to come to a head, and suddenly you've burnt loads and loads of time. So I think it's good for the company and also good for the candidate to get a really clear flavour of the culture during the recruitment process.
I agree. Any of those values that you can highlight, the ones that you said sometimes might be a bit Marmite?
Yeah, well, I think when you're a small company, that the culture does emanate from the founder. So I think a lot of the values I came up with were things that I particularly valued as a person. And naturally, because of my Northern roots, they were quite stereotypically Northern values. So one of our values, for instance, is stand up straight, which is essentially the idea of having a very direct, candid and critical communication style. I've never been a fan of kind of, you know, being overly diplomatic or fluffy. And I think for an early stage startup in particular, it's really important to be straight talking, because there's so much stuff going wrong because you're building something for the first time and you often don't have processes, that you need people who are willing to speak truth to power, be critical and not bury their head in the sand. So I think having a very straight talking culture where people say what they mean and mean what they say is so, so important at the early stage. If you have a culture which is overly diplomatic, political or even polite at times, I think that doesn't set the company up well for the long run. And that's a traditional Northern value, I suppose, of direct, plain speaking. But that's something I've tried to instill from day one.
I like it. And then with that kind of that culture in mind, how do you prioritize innovation within your company? Sort of encourage that culture of creativity and experimentation, I suppose, amongst your team?
I think, you know, you can sear it into the values of your company. You know, one of our values is called Change It Up, which is about not being afraid to fail, putting experimentation at the heart of everything we do, and breaking outside the industry silo. Because to be honest, when I started Zero Gravity, I didn't want to baseline ourselves against the competition, because the social mobility is a social problem that hasn't been solved. The competition, I didn't think, were doing a particularly good job of actually creating a scalable solution that worked for people. So when it came to like idea generation, I wanted our team to look far outside the sector we operated in to get ideas. And when it came to building our platform, some of our best, most effective features have been taking technologies that worked in a very different context and applying them to our own use case, whether it was using postcode data to build our algorithm to identify talent. That's something that media companies have been using for years to kind of socioeconomically target customers. Now we use that to build an algorithm to identify talent. Where it was how we built our mentor matching algorithm, we looked at how Deliveroo and Uber were building algorithms to match, you know, riders and takeaway eaters and drivers and people who wanted to ride taxis. So we kind of looked outside the sector and kind of made that the norm early on, which is like, don't obsess about what's going on within the kind of education and career sector. Let's actually look far outside. And so I think steering into your values is important. And I think when it comes to like experimentation in particular, which I think is key to innovation, I think that that's very cultural as well, because it's all well and good to have a executive on a podcast say, no, we really like failure in our company and we reward it and we kind of encourage it. But often that's not actually borne out in the practice of the day to day. And so the way we try to create that at Zero Gravity is, for instance, everyone's encouraged, you know, once every quarter to take a moonshot. And that moonshot will be agreed in advance with the person's manager. And it's not tracked in terms of targets. Now, the expectation is that 9 out of 10 times the moonshot will fail. But it kind of just gives permission, though, to concentrate on one thing every 3 months that might not work. But if it does work, it could lead to a new insight that could, you know, change the game for that person's position. So I think actually making it part of your system rather than just requiring people to kind of proactively, you know, be innovative or be experimental is a way you can give people permission to fail. So I think rather than just saying it on podcasts, I think you've got to walk the walk by tying it into your system. And yeah, that's how we've done it.
I love the idea of the moonshot. Any good examples of a recent moonshot that you've taken and moved it forward?
Yeah, we've taken so many moonshots. I remember in the early days of the company, we kind of acquired most of our signups through organic social media. And we used to run our own social media accounts and we did like a tiny bit of paid media. And we experimented once with a moonshot, which was we found all of these meme accounts on Instagram that were being run by 16-year-olds who were making like memes, joking about their exams and what was going on in school. And essentially we built an influencer campaign around these meme accounts where we paid around 20 different accounts, which were all run by 16-year-olds, a little bit of funding to create memes about Zero Gravity. And they posted them, and the kind of the amount of signups we got through that and the cost of acquisition was so much better than anything we've ever done before. So it was a moonshot, because the reporting to the board that I was paying around 20, 16-year-olds, you know, 20, 30 quid a post to create memes, like, was not necessarily the easiest thing to do, but it was an experiment and it worked. And a lot of our initial signups back in the early days, you know, came from little silly memes on social media. So it doesn't have to be a massive thing, like in terms of like a new product feature or a new way of working. Sometimes it can just be a small idea that you're not sure is going to work, but you give it a try, and sometimes the results can lead to a new insight. And the insight that we got out of that was that actually the influencer marketing with kind of nano or micro influencers, you know, could be very powerful for Zero Gravity. Now, you don't need to work with people who have got 1 million followers on YouTube or 100,000 followers on TikTok. You know, sometimes just working with a 16, 17-year-old who's built an audience of 10,000 people, and it's a very deep connection around their personal life or comedy, they can actually yield, you know, really, really good results. And that's an insight we still use to this day.
I love it. Absolutely love it. Moving on to technology. What role has technology played in the growth and success of Zero Gravity? And then how do you stay ahead of technological advancements in the industry, given obviously how fast it's all moving at the moment?
I think technology is at the heart of our operating model. Fundamentally, we're a tech platform that powers students from low opportunity backgrounds into top universities and careers. And from day one, I believe that proprietary technology, you know, could be a big part of the solution to social mobility, which doesn't sound too disruptive or innovative now. But back when I first proposed that in 2018, I met a lot of resistance. I remember when we were powering hundreds of students from low-income backgrounds into Oxford and Cambridge University, and I used to get all these invitations from the heads of Oxbridge colleges inviting me down. They wanted to see how the platform worked and what the Zero Gravity secret sauce was. And I kind of showed them just basic features like video calls. And there was a lot of skepticism about, you know, could you actually build a mentoring relationship over video? And could you deliver content effectively online? And this was all pre-COVID, but there was a lot of skepticism in the early days that you could, you know, deliver really high quality, long-term impact digitally, especially in the education sector. There was almost like a resistance to technology. So it was a big bet that I took in 2018, but I think it's paid off because even though technology has maybe got a bad name over the past 10 years, I think technology can be revolutionary in terms of leveling the playing fields. I think thinking through the expanse of human history, there's been so many technological revolutions which have democratized access to information, knowledge, and skills, whether it was the printing press, or the internet, or the web, or even social media. And I kind of see zero gravity as no following on that trajectory, as no finding a new way to utilize technology to make a social impact. And I think if the tech sector can get back to doing that, rather than kind of focusing on kind of shareholder returns at any cost without thinking of the social implications of some of those things, then I think tech has a lot to offer. I mean, in terms of how we stay ahead of the curve, I think one key thing is having technologists within the organization. And we've got a big product and engineering team of people who not only build the platform, but are obsessed with technology. And we encourage them to experiment and try different things. And a lot of them have side hustles and projects that they do outside work as well. And I see that as a really positive force because they can bring so many insights through other things that they're doing that into their day-to-day work at zero gravity. So like whether it's using AI or using new techniques in big data, we benefit so much from the technologists who are just incredibly curious about their sector. So I think trying to get people who are interested in technology in the company early doors is going to give you a massive competitive advantage because they know what's going on in the sector, they know what the latest and greatest technologies are, and there's bound to be a use case in your company for those.
Anything you can share with us today that's not confidential that's on your tech roadmap?
Well, like a lot of companies, we're really excited about generative AI. We implemented a number of AI features into our platform in Q1 of 2023, whether it was building a research tool for people to research universities and careers, or providing mentors with a AI bot to help them structure session plans, mentoring sessions. We've just found a lot of low-hanging fruit on our platform where the features were not quite personalized enough or a little bit manual beforehand. And we found a way to use generative AI to make those features far more automated and personalized to users on the platform. And we're really looking to double down on that because even though the humans are at the heart of zero gravity platform, I do believe human relationships can be enhanced with AI to take a lot of the grunt work out of the things people do. So I'll just give you one example of that, Robin. Students, they'd spend countless hours researching the universities and university courses. And often the research is really badly informed where they will have a couple of conditions. I want to go to university down south. I want to go to a city rather than a town. It has to be this degree subject. And they'll just do a filter-based analysis and end up with maybe 6 or 7 choices out of that. And the big problem is, not only does that analysis take quite a lot of time, but students miss a lot of opportunities through not knowing what's out there or being overly strict about their conditions. And what AI is so good at doing is it can turn the people's preferences into really well-researched, well-informed analysis. So you can tell a student, essentially, could rank a number of courses at different universities and say that these ones meet your preferences for this, but not for this, and do for that, but not for that. And it's almost like having a career advisor on steroids. And as your preferences and interests change over time, that can automatically be fed into the system. So that was something that was really difficult to do 24 months ago. You'd have to build a tech system with tens of thousands of lines of if-else statements. And I think our engineers will probably go a little bit crazy. But with large language models, doing that kind of analysis is now pretty straightforward if you build systems in the right way. So we're really excited about that as a new tool to get people looking at universities and careers that might pass them by otherwise. And I think that's going to be a game changer for people making better decisions about what they want to do with their life.
Yeah, I know. I absolutely agree. I think there's so much opportunity, as you say, with AI and Gen AI, but still keeping that human element all the time focused around that. Question for you around sort of investment. This podcast will hopefully go out to entrepreneurs who are probably at an earlier stage than you are on your growth journey, what strategies would you suggest they use to secure funding for the startup? And then what advice would you give to other founders seeking investment?
Yeah, it's a really important question, because when I first moved to London, I had absolutely no idea how the investment ecosystem worked for a startup. Like, I knew about kind of venture capital as a theory, but as a reality, like, I couldn't quite believe that people would invest hundreds of thousands of pounds in a company that had, you know, very few assets on its balance sheet and next to no revenue in the early days. So I knew the theory, but I didn't know actually how does the system work in practice. I think for an early stage founder, the brutal truth is that network is so important. You can have the most incredible business in the world and the best strategy and the incredible financial models, but if you're not able to get that business plan in front of the right people, it's going to be really difficult to get the investment you need. So I think if you're an early stage founder, especially one from a background where that network isn't inherited through your family or education network, you need to think about how you get in front of the right people. And as I mentioned at the beginning, the way I did that with Zero Gravity is I created a kind of PR media flywheel about the business that got the word about Zero Gravity out to a wide audience. And in particular, we targeted a number of broadsheet newspapers that I knew kind of high net worth angel investors would be reading. And that allowed me to bring a lot of people into my orbit who I never would have otherwise come across. And we've got a number of investors in Zero Gravity now who are kind of, you know, billionaires. They're on the Times or Forbes rich list. Like, I wasn't knocking about with these people 5 years ago. But the way I was able to reach them was creating that media flywheel. So I think when it comes to building a network, it's not so much about just being that relentless person who goes to every event or messages every person on LinkedIn. Even before you do that, you should think about what's the brand you're trying to build and the message you're trying to get out there. And is it one that's really going to kind of resonate and excite people? Because if it is, then you have the potential to bring people to you rather than you having to go to them. And that's going to make building a network so much easier.
Yeah, no, I agree. I was actually reading an article in Sifted on Friday talking about government support and whether it was government funding or government as a customer was the support we needed. What are your thoughts? Is it government funding or is it government as a customer, or is it a bit of both?
Usually government as a nightmare, in all honesty. Okay. I think that, to be fair, I mean, the two really good government schemes, which I had no idea about before I actually started to scale Zero Gravity, which are really powerful, is the SEIS and EIS tax break, and also the R&D tax credit. And maybe it's worth speaking about those for 30 seconds, because I had no idea these things existed when I started, but they've been right at the heart of our fundraising strategy. So the EIS and SEIS tax breaks are essentially tax credits for investors in early stage companies, which, you know, radically reduce the cost and risk of people investing. And it was really important for Zero Gravity, because we had so many high net worth angel investors, to ensure that our fundraising was done in an EIS compliant way. So we got advanced assurance for every single funding round we did. And that was, again, that's never going to drive your entire funding round. You need a great business underpinning it. But it does make a decision much easier for an investor if they know it's going to be done with the EIS tax credit in mind. And the second thing is the R&D tax credit, which is if you're an R&D intensive company like Zero Gravity, where you're building a lot of technology, it's proprietary, you're doing it in-house, you can actually, you know, take a lot of money off your costs by getting a tax credit from the government for R&D investment. Now, I had no idea this existed. Indeed, it wasn't in my very earliest financial models, but now it plays a big part, because, you know, every engineer that we hire at Zero Gravity, you know, roughly, you know, 25% of their salary that we can claim back as a tax credit. So those are two really good schemes which the government has, which I think for any early stage founder should be on your radar right at the beginning of your journey, because from a financial point of view, they're going to kind of grease the wheels of what you're doing.
Yeah, no, I absolutely agree. Although I really hope that the government take note of the recent changes to the who can actually apply the EIS and the SEIS and move it back down to the 100,000 mark soon.
Yeah, I think it's a really weird change. Of course, like many that there's been a lot of rip-off investments not offered to retail investments over the past 5 to 10 years. They're both within the scope of EIS and outside. So it's important that the government tries to step in to protect people from being ripped off. But I think putting a huge income and capital requirement on investing in startups is a really bad policy, not just for the tech sector, but also for social mobility as well. Because essentially what you're saying is the only people who should be able to invest in a tech company are people who are already rich. And in fact, the EIS tax break is really good. And I think we should be encouraging the young, ambitious, entrepreneurial people to get a flavor of actually what it's like to be in the tech sector. And one of the ways you can do that is by proactively investing in tech startups. And it doesn't need to be a huge amount. Like, you don't need to be writing £10,000 checks. That literally can be investing 50 quid of your salary through a crowdfunding platform. And I think just the kind of knowledge and discipline you get through doing that, of analysing other people's companies as an investment proposition, is going to refine your own kind of mindset around how you should build your own company. So I think we should be doing more to kind of open up the world of tech to more people from all backgrounds, not trying to restrict it to the wealthiest in society.
Yeah, fingers crossed that gets changed fairly quickly. Couple final questions from my side, Joe. If you could go back to the day you founded the company and change one thing along the way, or give yourself one piece of advice, what would it be?
I think I wish I would have started sooner, in all honesty. So I started Zero Gravity when I finished university at the age of 21. But I think the reality of growing a startup is it's impossible to be an overnight success. And from a cultural point of view, I think people are peppered with false examples of entrepreneurial success that make it look like, you know, a great idea is born overnight and then suddenly explodes. Like, I know a lot of people of my generation were inspired to go into tech startups by watching movies like The Social Network. You know, Jesse Eisenberg plays Mark Zuckerberg, and that makes the Facebook journey look like an overnight success. But in reality, even a kind of industry-defining company like Facebook took years and years before it transitioned from a kind of student college platform to like a worldwide social network. And I think that the thing that really makes a difference actually is just being in it for the long run, you know, being relentless and continuing to keep going and taking the kind of knockbacks for a far longer period of time than other people are willing to tolerate. And with that in mind, I think one of the key variables that's going to make a difference in success is essentially when you start, which is the earlier you can start, the better. Because if it takes 4 years of 1% growth every week to build a fantastic company, the earlier you get going on that 1% journey, the better. So I wish I'd started at the beginning of university, in all honesty, rather than waiting till I was 21. I think the reason I didn't try anything at university is because I think I falsely believed that I needed a kind of perfect set of skills and knowledge to get going as an entrepreneur, when actually a little bit of youthful naivety and blind optimism can go a long way.
I agree. And hopefully other entrepreneurs can watch this, Joe, and take that advice. What's your ambitions for Zero Gravity? Is US on your roadmap?
Yeah, so I want to create the industry-defining company for breaking the link between background and opportunity. And it's been a crazy journey to date. You know, we've scaled from supporting a couple of hundred students per year to now 10,000 plus per year. We've got 10,000 plus school students from low opportunity backgrounds on our platform who applied to university this year. So the growth of the platform has been exponential. We're now supporting people into careers with a number of the UK's biggest companies. And now I want to keep scaling Zero Gravity to hundreds of thousands of people now, because there's loads of people in this country who have all the talent and ambition to achieve incredible things and are just restrained by the circumstances of their background. And I believe technology has the ability to break that link. And if we can do it in the UK, then why can't we do it across the globe? That every Western economy, every developed country has a big social mobility problem. It's not just a UK-specific issue. And I think this is the existential question they're facing the West, in all honesty, because without wanting to sound like a kind of history lecture at university, I do think this is a civilizational challenge. where societies that are best able to utilise talent from all backgrounds are the ones whose values win out over the long run. And if we want the next 100 years to be at the kind of Western century where the kind of ideas of democracy, human rights, liberal values win the day, then we need to do a much better job of utilising talent from all backgrounds. Because if we don't do that, someone else will, and it won't necessarily be civilizations aligned with the values that we like in this country. So I see this as one of the biggest questions facing any government. It's not kind of a second order issue to deal with. It goes right to the very heart of, does the country work for everyone, and are we able to use talent from all backgrounds?
I absolutely love that, Joe. What a real passion, and I love the mission. Final question, bit of a silly one, but if your startup had a theme song, what would it be and why?
I'm not sure if this is a little bit cringe or cliche, but when we were designing the Zero Gravity brand back in the early days, I created a kind of mood board of different cultural references that I thought brought to life the emotion that I wanted the brand to create with our members. And I wanted to find cultural references that captured the idea of like youthful ambition and energy, and not feeling trapped by your background, feeling like you have the ability to defy the odds and do something extraordinary. And one of the clips that I took was the scene in Perks of Being a Wallflower, where the car drives under the tunnel and Emma Watson is on the back of the car and puts her arms out to David Bowie's song Heroes. And it's like a wonderful cultural moment I think a lot of young people who've seen that movie remember, because it is all about kind of youthful, feeling of youthful empowerment and not feeling trapped anymore by your roots. And that was the kind of energy I wanted the Zero Gravity brand to capture. So Heroes by David Bowie has quite a strong connection with the brand, I think, as a result of that.
I'm a big Bowie fan, so that's a classic, and that gets my thumbs up, definitely, Joe. That's all from us. To find out more about Zero Gravity and the Super Connect for Good competition, follow the QR code at the end of the video and head over to Hays' technology website. Also, keep an eye out for our next video, when I'll be meeting a regional winner in the Super Connect for Good competition to discuss their journey and how they're using tech for good. Thank you and goodbye.